for your safety and the safety of others, please listen to the following safety instructions. Please walk and not run while entering and exiting America.
You were born in the States, is that correct?
Yes, I was born in Tacoma, and I just went back for the first time, because I was an Army brat, and so I was only there for 6 months before we went to the next place, and I just went back for the first time, so it was pretty surreal, because I don't have any relatives there.
Yeah.
It's interesting.
What was your thoughts then?
I felt like in a Jim Jarmusch movie.
Oh.
Because it's a very quiet city, and it seems like the economy isn't doing really well, so it was pretty empty.
Yeah.
And we didn't have a car, so we were just kind of walking through these quiet streets and didn't really know what to do either. With and then, you know, we had our luggage and our instruments with us.
Oh.
And I don't know, it was just, we were sitting at bus stations continuously waiting for buses that took a long time.
Bit like canoeing through, like Johnny Depp in the Jim Jarmusch movie.
Right. It just had this kind of, I mean, Jim Jarmusch films always have so much time, you know. He and that's the way it felt, because everything took a long time,
yeah.
And so it was very surreal and Jim Jarmusch like. It's funny.
Mm. How did it come about that you spent time in Berlin?
In 1987, I wanted to visit Berlin for 2 weeks, and I had just seen Wings of Desire by Wim Wenders before.
Yeah.
And I had one friend there, and I went to visit her, and she lived in a kind of apartment with different people, and one of the people living there was the keyboarder of Nick Cave.
Oh.
And. Mm-hmm. And he knew all the people that had participated in Wings of Desire, so
yeah.
I was kind of also there. I had the feeling I was suddenly immersed in a movie, because I felt like I was in Wings of Desire. I suddenly was talking and interacting with all the people that had been there.
Mm.
And within days, I noticed that it had, you know, just as many galleries and artists and musicians and everything as New York did.
Yeah.
But it wasn't as dangerous and it wasn't as expensive. So I was like, I'm staying. So I just stayed.
Yeah. And you enjoyed that period in time? Was that a good experience in Berlin?
Yes, absolutely. It was amazing. It was like being in heaven for that, what I was interested in. It was incredible.
Mm.
I mean, it was like a city only made up of creative people.
Yeah.
And I only had to work in a cafe once a week to be able to survive.
Wow.
I lived in a huge factory space where we could roller skate.
Yeah.
So it was pretty amazing.
Yeah, that's gone, that kind of thing, isn't it?
Yeah.
Like, yeah, it's gone.
It was incredible.
Yeah.
And I mean, that lasted until about 95, because you know, when the wall came down, it was another kind of adventure. So
yeah.
Basically, until 95, it was anarchy. So
yeah,
you could do anything you wanted, and it was just wonderful.
Yeah, nobody butted in, really.
No, you could. It was really in every way creative. You could. There was so much empty space you could use any way you wanted. There were no rules, because nobody really knew what belonged to who.
That's right.
So it was there to do with what you wanted to do with. And, you know, creative people usually don't destroy things. They make it beautiful or do music or whatever. So it was very, it was a very positive time. It was great. Everybody was in the same boat. So there was no competition.
Right.
And people just work together.
Right.
So until 95, it was pretty amazing.
Do you think that's what turned the boat over, that people no longer worked together? Do you think that's what happened about after that period?
Yeah, as soon as the industry moved in and people started wanting to make money off of it and cash in off of the creativity, that's when competition started. A lot of people started coming in from the outside that had completely different means of doing things. So, I mean, the Berliner per se was wasn't rich. Nobody needed money.
Yeah.
Money wasn't necessary. which was the incredible thing about it. And the special thing about Berlin was that it wasn't trendy. It was actually pretty, you know, people used to say, Berlin, yeah, it's, you either like it or you hate it.
Yep.
And they're kind of crazy over there. They do these crazy things.
Yeah.
So that's the difference to today, that Berlin back then was not trendy. Now it's become trendy, and that kind of makes everything different, because if you're a trend, you're part of a mass
movement,
which is dictated by the industry, and that was the exact opposite back then. So
yeah.
As soon as the industry moved in, it kind of changed everything.
I was in Berlin before the war, and I was there after the war. So I saw a difference too. It did change a lot.
Yeah.
People's attitudes changed, and also the attitude of other people from other cities changed, you know, especially when they came back, they wanted to rejoin the two parts of the country. You know, some were not happy to be, you know, having to finance East Berlin's comeback.
Yes.
So there was a lot of bitterness there, which I found very strange.
Yeah. Kind of bitterness from all sides. I mean, within, let's say, the creative scene of Berlin, everybody kind of merged and mingled. I mean, I worked in clubs back then, and there were people from East Berlin, you know, DJing or being bouncers, and everything was okay. But politically, there was a lot of bitterness, of course, from both sides, from the East side because they felt that they had missed out on a lot, and from the West side because they felt that they had to finance a lot of things that they weren't really capable of. I mean, Berlin was bankrupt, I think, I don't think it's bankrupt anymore, but up to a couple of years ago, there was no money, and of course you could feel that in every level.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, it's still not a very rich city. It's still, you know.
No.
I think that, you know, when I lived in Vienna for a long time, and there used to be a lot of programs showing places in Germany, you know, in their documentaries or films or whatever. And very often they show Berlin because Berlin is one of the few places which is actually trendy in the whole country. You know, if you go to any of the other cities, they're kind of like, well, you know, conservative, sort of classical German places. But Berlin seems to be the place that they use to make it look like, you know, things are progressing in some art. In some artistic form.
Did you get the idea to do the parade and, you know, these musical shows, let's say?
Well, I mean, back then I was together with my boyfriend, Matthias Röhring, Motte, and he was a DJ, and I don't know, as soon as I came to Berlin, I started organizing things. Back then I was doing all kinds of different stuff. And I don't know, it was a general atmosphere in Berlin to do stuff together. There were constantly people, you know, initiating things together, organizing parties or fashion shows or concerts or, you know, festivals. Or it was just because everybody was so interactive. It was a natural thing to kind of organize things where you would do things together with people because it just felt like interacting. And there were, you know, there were big movements or collaborations like the Geniale Dilettanten Ur Neubaut and that whole scene came from. And so people were doing a lot of things in groups anyway, much more than in other cities that I had experienced before. And when I came to Berlin in 87, it was kind of like a rock city. There were a lot of rock things happening. Mm-hmm. A lot of rock music was popular. And it was still kind of like 70s revival with a lot of Motown parties and 70s things. And, of course, the Neue Deutsche Welle and the Geniale Dilettanten and all of that.
Yeah.
Hip-hop was coming a little bit, like Motte used to DJ hip-hop evenings. It was kind of like a mixture of all kinds of things, and you could tell it was the end of a specific era.
Right.
And everybody was really kind of looking for something new, which is interesting because that's different from the way I never was like that again, or I never felt it that much again, that you really had the feeling it was it was the end of something.
Yeah.
And we started hearing about, you know, raves happening in England. Mm-hmm. And we had also often spoken about parades in general, kind of, you know, I mean, Germany has a history of specific parades.
That fits with their culture, that's true, yes.
Yeah. And, you know, I come from America, and parades are a big part of the culture here.
Yeah, that's right.
And we always like the really colorful ones.
Yeah.
So, we were speaking about that more and more, and then at one point, Marta came home one day after DJing in a club and said, you know, why don't we just do a parade?
Mm-hmm.
Why don't we just do a parade on the street and just show, you know, present the music that we like,
mm-hmm.
in the overground, because we were always in the underground. He said, you know, it's so boring to always be kind of like in this specific area. Let's do something where everybody can see it, and the mainstream, the housewives who go shopping. So everybody can hear what we're doing. So it's not such a, you know, closed off kind of thing.
Actually, going back to that point where you spoke about hip-hop, Nina Hagen did a hip-hop track, New York, New York. She did one of the first rap tracks, earlier, long before Falco, I think, and some of these others.
Yeah, true.
Yeah.
I mean, it was... In Berlin, it became stronger. Like, I was in a kind of crossover hip-hop band later on.
Yeah.
And that was when hip-hop was pretty strong in Berlin. That must have been, like, 92.
Yeah.
There were a lot of hip-hop bands that kind of emerged. But they kind of disappeared again, too. I think that Berlin was never really a hip-hop city. It was more kind of industrial techno from its...
Yeah,
atmosphere.
That's right. I remember going to stores there, and there's some very good techno bars or clubs. They had quite a few. I remember being in Berlin at one time, and that was the case. And I think the problem with hip-hop is that it's so much about money that you have to go to those cities that are about money, like Stuttgart, Munich.
Yeah.
Yeah?
Yes, that's true.
Yeah.
That's true. So we just organized it. I said, I think that's a great idea. I was, you know, I'm always happy to do things that are unconventional.
Mm.
And let's organize it together and organize it as a demonstration. Because, for one, we didn't have money to organize anything that cost money. But two, it was also something, it really was something where it was just this urge to go out of those basements.
Yeah,
you know, underground clubs out into the sun, kind of.
Yeah.
So and to kind of tell people, hey, you know, because Berlin was a very kind of dark city for a long time.
Yeah.
It was, you know, it had that kind of heroin, melancholic atmosphere, and you could feel it was time for something to change, to become a little bit more positive, and I mean, the whole techno movement is a completely different thing than what was going on before. You know, it's much more hedonistic and colorful and kind of
right,
you know, it's not melancholic at all.
No. But it is, you know, that's also partly to do with what Germany's going through, you know, its changes, the reunification,
right?
Kind of, you know, that took them 10 years or so to come through, and probably, I don't know if they've come through it even till now, but you know, they had to go through that.
Yeah, I mean, Germany, you know, is when I came to Germany in 87, I was actually quite surprised at how Germany still was very conscious of its guilt of the Second World War, you know.
Mm.
And so besides that whole thing, there was also the country which was divided, so it had this very, I don't know, kind of heavy atmosphere.
Yeah.
And you really had the feeling then that, especially the youth, was kind of like, you know, but we want to have fun.
Mm.
We don't want to feel guilty and terrible all the time, which is understandable because, you know, we were all 20. So it's kind of like, we want to have fun. We want to enjoy life. We want to be able to, you know, we don't constantly want to have to think about horrible political things. And I think that kind of was part of it, that people really just wanted to lift that cloud a little bit. And that was a very important part of the whole parade. And you could tell the relief of people because, you know, the first time we did it was 150 people and we were just walking on the street.
Yeah.
And people just stopped at the side of the street with their shopping bags because it was a Saturday, you know, they just went shopping. And they just couldn't believe it because I had asked a lot of friends to come and dress up a little bit color, you know, more colorful than usual. Mm. I had a couple of friends that were doing costume design and one that was kind of doing jewelry design and she was designing armor. And so she came with a couple of strange shields and stuff. And another one who's a hat designer. So, you know, the other people just wore t-shirts and stuff like that. But and we were just dancing and it rained in between.
Mm.
We continued dancing and it was such a relief. You had the feeling that everybody who was watching it and everybody who was doing it was kind of like,
thank God.
Wow.
Thank God.
This is fun.
Thank God it's Friday.
Yes, exactly. Exactly. And I think that's why it was so popular. I think that's why, I mean, we never expected it. To, you know, we didn't even think we were going to do it more than two times, max. But I think that's one of the reasons why it became so popular, because it was a demonstration for something, not against something.
Yeah.
And it was done with real love for music and kind of with the thought that music is for everybody. There's music goes over all boundaries.
Yeah.
Nobody gets left out. Everything is, it's like, you know, it's a positive thing. And I think that it became that popular also had a lot to do with it being in Germany and kind of that atmosphere being there before. It was such a relief, especially for the, you know, for everybody. So,
well, you kind of took them back to the 1920s when they had their last good time.
Exactly. Yeah.
After that, it was a bit, you know, it was a bit of a stumbling block for about, I don't know, 50 years, 60 years.
Yeah.
It's a long time.
Yes.
I know that guilt stuff. I lived in Austria. It's the same thing. You know, it causes a schism in their minds.
Oh, totally.
Yeah.
Totally.
Yes. It's the other interesting thing is that most of the Europeans who live in the States are German.
A lot.
Their roots are German.
True.
Yeah.
Oh, true.
No, I've read that. That it's.
Oh, really?
Yeah, I've studied that. I'm a journalist. I look into things.
Yeah, yeah.
Most of the Europeans who live in the States are Germans by root.
Wow, interesting.
Yeah.
I mean, there's a lot of Irish.
Yes,
in New York.
Irish. Yeah.
But true, there's a whole town in Texas.
They drink.
We found out.
They must be drinking down there like hell.
Well, we only drove past on tour, but it was funny because we suddenly. We're driving past this kind of town, and we're like, this looks really German.
Right.
And then it said Germanville or something.
Right.
Like, oh, wow.
And tomorrow is a beer fest.
Yeah. Yeah.
Well, don't you miss being in Germany a little bit, or are you happy to be back in the States?
Well, I mean, I was in Germany until 4 years ago.
Mm.
And, I mean, when I moved to Berlin initially, until about 95, I felt, you know, perfect. I felt totally at home and extremely happy, and I loved it. I really, really loved it. Then, because of all the changes, it became more, I don't know. I mean, you know, for me, the interesting thing was, of course, the creativity and the situation that it was just kind of a no man's land. I mean, it was German, but it wasn't really typical German because it was so, it was such anarchy. So when 95, when the industry moved in, it became, I guess, more like a regular city, you know, and the humor and the possibilities and the anarchy, I mean, they're still there to a certain extent. I don't want to say that it's not there. It's still a very, very special city, but it has become more mainstream. And by becoming more mainstream, I started noticing more that I actually came from a different country.
Mm.
So I started missing things. I just started missing certain things that, you know, being an American. So I started feeling like the typical expat, you know, that is always kind of like I don't know, like, have a child with divorced parents. You always want both.
Yeah, yeah.
So I kind of thought I'd really like to be more in both places. So ultimately, that's kind of what I want. I want to be 50-50, 50% in Germany and 50% in the U.S.
Mm.
I think once you've become an expat, it never changes because you know both sides and you know the good sides of both sides. So
yeah,
you're always going to miss something.
Of course, of course.
So
how did that, how many times did you do the parade? How long did you do that?
I did it together with much of the first 4 years. And of course, there was a huge group of people that started helping and organizing and all that.
Yeah.
And I'm just not a very, I don't like masses. Mm-hmm. They kind of worry me after a certain size.
Mm-hmm.
And so I kind of lost interest too. But then in 98, I think, 97, 98, I participated twice, two more times together with him. And we initiated this art parade within the Love Parade because it had become extremely commercial by then.
Yeah.
And I could see that Motta was pretty unhappy. And I kept on thinking, you know, I mean, the way we started out was something which was so,
simple.
You know, no money. It was creative. It was done in this enthusiasm for positive things and for the love of music. And I thought, now it's all about money. And so, you know, it's just money, and that's
disgusting.
It.
Disgusting.
So, yeah. So I told him, you know, why don't we try doing something to go back to the roots, kind of, and kind of try and push people's awareness back into that what originated it, which is creativity. And I said, why don't we do something which kind of includes different things? So we organized, we asked, like, I think it was 19 people that were musicians, actors, artists, to draw really big billboards in one street. Like, each person had their own billboard, and was called Brave New World. And they were supposed to kind of draw something within one day, the day before the Love Parade.
Right.
And then we auctioned it off and gave the money to a music therapy place. Because we thought, you know, this big parade is generating so much money, but it's all money for personal pleasure or whatever of the people who are doing it. Let's put it back into something that has to do with music and that's got a little bit more of an intention than just material goods.
Yeah.
So we did that twice.
Did people accept that, though, or did they send a hitman out for you?
Well, they didn't send the hitman out, but it was kind of like they didn't care.
Yeah.
You know, so we really generated a lot of money. I think the first time we, at the auction, we generated 50,000 D-marks.
Mm-hmm. That's not bad.
That's pretty good.
Yeah.
And we gave it to this music therapy place. And the second time, almost the same amount.
Mm-hmm.
So it was effective in that way that we could actually really, you know, do something. But, I mean, the people that participated were enthusiastic, and a couple of people that came and the people that auctioned were. But otherwise, the typical Love Parade person that came, you know, he didn't want to do it. He just wanted to dance and take ecstasy and just have fun.
And freak out.
Know. Yeah, so it was kind of like, okay, this is just not that what it used to be. And then
wouldn't you give it another try? Couldn't you give it another try, maybe? You know, maybe people have changed, or do you think it's worse now?
I don't think that, you know, repeating something works. I think it was, you know, the time, it was the right time, the right place, the right people, the right feeling. And I think nowadays it's a different, you know, it's a different era. There's different things that that are important
to people. So, yeah. Well, it at least influenced other cities to do the same kind of parade because they have one in Vienna now. That's basically, I think, a copy of what they were doing in Germany, you know.
Yeah. Are they still doing it?
But I was there a few years ago and they were doing it. I don't know. They probably must be, I suppose. It makes a lot of money.
Yeah. But it also kind of, I don't know, I have this feeling it's fizzling out everywhere. I really think it was, I don't know.
Time.
generation or specific era, because there used to be a lot everywhere.
Yeah,
I think there was even one in Israel at one point.
Yeah,
but
wow.
But I stopped following it at one point because I'm not that much into techno anymore, right. And I do different kind of music now. So I'm, and like I said, I just don't feel comfortable in big groups. So
yeah, well, I'm the same actually.
Yeah, makes me get claustrophobic.
Puts me on edge. It puts me on edge.
Me too.
Yeah.
I get claustrophobic.
Yeah. I've got the feeling that my pockets will be picked, but it's just the crowd.
Exactly. Because a crowd thinks differently than a single person, and if it's a positive thing, it's good. If it turns into something negative, it can be horrible. Yeah. So.
In his hands, it looked like a toothpick. I turned to take the money from a customer when the world behind me exploded. The walls seemed to stretch in a strange way, and pulsing silence spread like thick cream covering the stars.